They alter the pH of the soil.
All right, so all of these mangoes for free, homies. Absorption. Just fucking power rinse them real quick. I'm using this as a strainer because it has the gaps. Fuck it, man. Just take out the sticker. Also,
by the way, Monsanto has genetically engineered
gonna make a fucking mango juice for the first time. They're all free. Look at that.
Plant genome of the plant be genetically engineered. So basically, their goal is to wipe out all of the plant life on the planet, replace it with genetically engineered versions that we all have to buy from them.
I'm tripping, dude. The juicer doesn't discriminate.
But this one has a sticker,
and there's some firm ones and some soft ones.
And the firm ones will
help push out the soft, soggy stuff, so it won't back up. You said this one's all pale.
Supplies,
it's all good.
It
has some life force in it.
They get into the brain and into some the nervous energy. System. They short circuit their neural pathways, and then you wind up with neuromuscular disorders like multiple sclerosis or
different varieties too. They're not all the same.
Parkinson's disease,
same type.
Autism, and so I help a lot of people heal those completely by simply removing the heavy metals out of their nervous systems and brains.
Still nice and yellow.
Now here's an interesting one, and this is very pertinent to California. Aluminum powder is a fire accelerant. It's used in fireworks. It's one of the main ingredients in fireworks. It makes them burn. So when you go spraying this all across the landscape, and it gets all over the trees and the plants, what happens when there's a drought, or even if there's not a drought, and you get a fire? It's going to be way, way worse. And that, in fact, is exactly what's going on. If you talk to firefighters, they'll tell you the fires nowadays are far worse and far faster than they used to be. And it's because these metals are sitting out on these plants. And as I mentioned, aluminum causes brain and nervous system damage. It lodges in the brain and short circuits brain neural pathways and the nervous system. Now, the fallacy that, you know, that what they're publicly trying to promote is that, oh, we're doing this to combat global warming or climate change or whatever euphemism you want to use. But in fact, it's been discovered that these metals, because they stay up in the atmosphere so long and they're so light and reflective, that they don't drop to the earth that fast. And so they wind up, although they do reflect the sunlight on the sunny side of the earth and lower the surface temperature of the earth, On the dark side of the planet, it's not facing the sun. It acts as
nice and bright and yellow.
So it doesn't have a net effect of lowering the surface temperature of the Earth. And of course, when you put metal particles, fine metal particles, in the atmosphere is an ocean of highly charged particles that need to be in balance in order for us to have normal weather.
There you go, man.
When you throw all these charged particles of metal up in there, we get severe weather of all kinds. Droughts, floods, tornadoes, hurricanes, freezing cold, massive snowstorms, etc., etc. And so back when all this was going on, when Fukushima first occurred, I'm kind of lazy, so you know, I don't feel like I have any duty to save humanity. I really like saving my own butt. So when all this, I saw this going on, I said, well, I gotta find a solution for this, because I'm not putting up with it. So I spent about a year and a half working my tail off, and I developed a device that will clear these pollutants, all pollutants, out of the atmosphere for about a 75-mile radius. And it doesn't drop it back down onto the ground, it sends it out into space. And so what I discovered was, when you clean the pollution out of the atmosphere, you don't get severe weather, because it balances the ionization of the atmosphere. Severe weather, like lightning storms or strong winds, so the more pollutant the air is, the more likely it is to get severe weather. When you clean it out, the less severe weather
you
get. Interestingly enough, even when the storms come through, for example, in Florida, where we are now protected by these devices, we haven't had a hurricane since 2005. That's very unusual for Florida. That's because the atmosphere is clean in most parts. And so if you watch, if you follow hurricanes and tropical storms from these that come up from the south, usually down from Cuba up to Florida, they just die when they get to Florida. There's a reason for that. So we've seen this all across the world, and it's not just me. There are lots of people putting these kinds of devices out and doing this, and everywhere I've seen this done, you get the severe weather goes away, you get normal rainfall. We put the deserts and the desert screen up. And, you know, Sharon touched on this in her talk earlier, but Wilhelm Reich discovered that, or postulated at least, that deserts all across the world are actually areas of ancient wars or else geopathic stress from certain types of mineral formations underground. And so the frequencies of energy coming out there are what causes desertification. So if you fix that energy frequency with these devices, guess what? The deserts green up. And that's exactly what's going on, for example, in Arizona. Go visit Sedona, and you'll see it's green there now, and they've got plenty of rain. Not too much rain, they've got just enough. So, why would they do that? Well, for one thing, you make money, as I mentioned, on controlling the atmosphere through investments in weather futures. Through the Chicago Mercantile Exchange. I don't know if there are other exchanges now that you can do that, but you can bet on the weather and make money if the weather goes sour. And as I mentioned, because these metals suppress conventional crops and wild plants and prevent them from uptaking nutrients, you can sell GMOs and make huge amounts of money selling GMO crops all across the world. Of course, you can also reduce population because these things suppress people's immune systems, they make them sick. And if you combine that with a food supply that is severely lacking in nutrients and a medical system that doesn't really heal people and an insurance industry to fund all of that, you've got a perfect system for reducing population. And of course, I mentioned military and political agendas, and many more. So I'm going to zoom over these slides. This is just evidence of geoengineering in various places that you can go online and see, and you can watch these slides later to check these out online if you want. The American Meteorological Society, they did a paper on indirect and semi-direct aerosol campaigns, the impact on Arctic aerosols on clouds. And you can see there's 16 scientists on this paper. And that's not all of them. There's another 16. So there are 32 scientists involved in this study for the American Meteorological Society. The Council on Foreign Relations, our good buddies at the Council on Foreign Relations who care so deeply about us, they did a workshop, and you can go to their website and see this. This is all public. It's not hidden. It's not behind passwords and logins. A workshop on geoengineering, unilateral planetary scale geoengineering. You think our governments don't know about this? They absolutely know about this. They're doing the other governments in the world. This is part of the agenda of the workshop. Science. World's leading journal of original scientific research, Global News and Commentary, has lots of articles on geoengineering. Here's one called The Politics of Geoengineering. How to convince people that this is a good thing. Shifting the debate on geoengineering. That's another article on their site. A test for geoengineering. There's tons of this stuff online. Why would you want to shift the debate on geoengineering? Because you've got to be able to shift
mango juice.
Perception that spraying metals in the atmosphere is like toxic and crazy and insane.
Straight mango juice.
Oh, it's good.
It's
just warm.
It's like, hey, you know, people should spray arsenic in the upper atmosphere all across the globe, you know, and that might help stop global warming. Yeah, well, it might kill everybody before global warming gets
in the fridge.
That's another story, right?
They're nice and cold.
This stuff is patently and obviously absurd. And they, you know, David Keith and others admit this in their public talks, and yet they still propose it because they're out to make a lot of money. And there are other agendas. Here's one from the Atmospheric Radiation Measurement Program from the U.S. Department of Energy, indirect and semi-direct aerosol campaigns. This is a really interesting one. This is a 57-page research paper that the Air Force commissioned, and of course they claimed that, oh, we just did this, you know, to study the feasibility of engineering the weather, but we're not going to do it, you know. But it's a 57-page paper, and they lay out very precisely in here what they're doing and why they're doing it, or what they want to do and why they're doing it. But they make no bones about it. It's called Weather as a Force Multiplier, Owning the Weather in 2025. And they stipulate they have a goal to own the weather globally by 2025 for warfare purposes and for other purposes. And again, this is public. It's amazing, you know. You just have to know to look for it. You know, nobody's out there looking for it. I'm looking for it. Because I know, being an engineer and being a geek, you, if this stuff is really going on, there have to be patents for it, there have to be systems for it, there has to be a lot of evidence, and there is. But nobody's looking for it much. I'm sure Michael Murphy's going to be talking about that, that paper trail. Here's another one, a conference on climate engineering. Earth Sciences, another journal on geoengineering. Geoengineering Watch, a really phenomenal resource on the details of this stuff. Although, again, they don't offer any solutions, they just point out the problem. That was, by the way, on that page, it's 320 plus patents on geoengineering that they have links to. 320. You can Google geoengineering, the regulation of geoengineering. This is the UK House of Commons Science and Technology Committee. They have a report presented to them called the Regulation of Geoengineering. And in that report, they note the need to work with the United States Congress. They know about it. Stratospheric injection. Oh, and by the way, on that downloads page, there's like six pages of notes with all these links and stuff, so you don't need to write any of this stuff down. You can just go there and download. It's like six pages of all these links that you can go and click on, and including these search terms I put here. But stratospheric injection of reflective aerosols. Man, if I had a dime for every time that I was sitting around thinking about stratospheric injection of reflective aerosols. You know, I just can't believe I didn't Google it before. You know, who's going to Google this stuff? We're not, you know. And especially if you're sitting around watching, you know, television and the crazy movies and stuff that people have. I don't watch TV and I don't watch the media and I don't plug into that stuff. And so it's being used for mind control, so I don't plug into that. So I do sit around thinking about this stuff.
I'm gonna have to use some cookies to push it out, because I don't got no more firm.
Use your old ones. Your old captives. And there should be cold. Should probably make your juice cold, if anything.
To add some antioxidants. Thank you. It's Bomba. Money can't buy this, homies. No matter how much money you got. You gotta make that shit fresh at home. Drink all of these, man.
Hey, leave me a mason jar for late so I could juice myself.
There's a mason jar in the refrigerator, I think.
I washed all of them.
Alright, nice piece.
It's 20 minutes long. I'm gonna cut this. I'm already getting thirsty, man.
Alright, cool.